What I'd like to do in my paper is to really try to capture the notion that trauma is no longer, it's no longer useful to look at trauma as an event, as, you know, the spectacular, the extraordinary event that leads to some symptoms, that we need to broaden our conceptualization of trauma, that the time is now, especially because here in South Africa, in countries that are represented around the table here, we have witnessed this reality, that it's no longer something that exists in the past or that has been repressed and is only coming out now, but it's also, perhaps more importantly, the daily, everyday traumas, or the insidious traumas, as some scholars have called it. I want to draw also from our experiences on the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, because contested as it was, as the process is, there are insights, there are wonderful insights from the Truth and Reconciliation that we gain, both in terms of understanding how people express trauma and how people heal from trauma. The transition process from apartheid to democracy brought South Africa to an awe-inspiring threshold of a bright and hopeful future for its citizens. Yet it seems clear that South Africa has not lived up to this dazzling image of change and transformation. In the past 10 to 15 years, we have witnessed the emergence of different forms of violence, especially crowd violence that often leads to brutal killings nationally, xenophobic violence, unspeakable forms of rape, and reports of violence committed by the police against citizens. After the miracle story of transition to democracy and the much lauded but contested role of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in this democratic transition, these are worrying trends. Research by scholars in the social psychology and peace building field has shown compellingly that past traumas tend to be passed on intergenerationally, and that the memory of the humiliation associated with historical trauma often provokes violence in communities that have suffered collective experiences of trauma and oppression over an extended period. In contrast, however, we've witnessed that in Rwanda, there hasn't been this kind of violence that we've seen in South Africa. And so it's important to consider, as part of our thinking and conversations about these issues, the problem of historical trauma and its repercussions in a comparative context, so that you can understand what it is about countries like South Africa that yield so much violence. Current debates on historical trauma and its transgenerational legacies came into prominence in the 1990s with the rise of studies investigating the repercussions of the Holocaust among descendants of survivors, the second and third generation of survivors of the Holocaust. At the same time, the popularity of studies of historical trauma in the 1990s in the humanities and social sciences was linked to the rise of memory studies and the various ways in which past trauma, and in particular historical trauma, is represented among descendants of survivors and their communities. The reference point for the canonical text on historical trauma and memory, and for the lesser known scholars in this field, has mainly been the Holocaust, or other perspectives inspired by Euro-American case studies. We in South Africa and other countries similar to our story are uniquely placed as scholars and practitioners coming from other cultural or alternative cultural, or from other cultures, to offer alternative ways of understanding these stories and to shift the lenses to a focus in a changing global context in order to explore new avenues of inquiry in the field. That victims, perpetrators, and beneficiaries of oppressive regimes live in the same country, and in some cases closely together as neighbors after violent conflict, would seem to have considerable impact on how survivors and their descendants, on the one hand, and perpetrators and beneficiaries and their descendants on the other frame narratives of historical trauma. I am interested in a more social relational account of these narratives as a fulcrum of its for explaining the human action that unfolds in the post-conflict context, especially in our country. It is, of course, important to build on the work that has already been done, but also to go further and expand the conceptual framework and take into account the socio-cultural context in which traumatic memory occurs. This, in my view, will lead to a deeper analysis of the complex matrix of the interacting factors of historical trauma and its intergenerational consequences in post-apartheid South Africa and in other countries that face the challenges of the past. Our focus on the area of such profound social relevance goes to the heart of the issues at the forefront of contemporary debates about historical trauma, its expression in memory and other symbolic forms such as violence, and most importantly, how to heal societies where these occur. Having witnessed firsthand what's happening in our streets, in our communities in South Africa, we have a responsibility to go beyond theoretical debate, to engage with questions that have been seldom explored in the field of trauma studies, to shift the lens to new directions that take advantage of our unique position of having been witnesses to the violence of the past and being witnesses to the everyday traumas that affect communities at the margins of society. Some of the most destructive acts of violence to the human soul are the subtle, systematic acts of violence that undermine the dignity and sense of worth of individuals, the insidious acts of violence that destroy their psychological and spiritual integrity, the forms of violence that Laura Brown refers to as insidious trauma that results from ongoing depravity, humiliation and degradation rather than from the spectacular and extraordinary violence. Scholars in a range of fields have addressed these important questions of trauma and memory. However, very few of these works address the central question of the complex interplay of the historical, political, and everyday traumatic dimensions of memory when victims live in the same country with perpetrators, bystanders, and beneficiaries. A notable exception to this trend is the book by Judy Atkinson, in which she examines the transmission of the trauma of colonization and oppression of Aboriginal Australians across generations. Atkinson draws a link between contemporary violence within Australian Aboriginal communities and the traumatic past of the parents' generation. Another text that is exemplary of this trend that has emerged in the 21st century scholarship on historical trauma is research conducted by Elizabeth Jellin and Susan Kaufman on memory in the aftermath of the Argentinian Dirty War. Their study, Layers of Memory, 20 years after the Argentinian War, investigates narratives constructed about the past across three generations and the different events and initiatives, such as attempts to establish memorials, monuments, and that show the range of ways in which collective memories are expressed and how people work through these memories in order to heal these layers of trauma and meanings attached to the memories. The work of these scholars, Atkinson, Jennings, and Kaufman, gestures towards another trend in trauma studies that has emerged in the 21st century. A growing number of scholars are questioning, on the one hand, the uncritical, undifferentiated use of trauma in the study of mass violence, what Michael Rothberg refers to as the homogenization of trauma. On the other hand, the intellectual canons of trauma theory have been criticized for their almost exclusive focus on the traumatic experiences of Westerners, marginalizing traumatic events that have occurred in other parts of the globe, and using methodologies drawn from a Euro-American context. This view, held by, among others, Steph Krebs and Brett Bullens, is becoming very central in debates on trauma today. These scholars, of course, are scholars in post-colonial studies, literary studies, but still, the notions that they debate are very much focused on reflections on what trauma means and how people express trauma and how they work through trauma. So according to Krebs and Bullens, this set kind of avoidance or ignoring of stories from other cultures shows an indifference to real world issues such as history, politics, and ethics. They have argued for the development of an alternative canon of trauma theory, one that will lead to a cross-cultural ethical engagement in this field. Canadian oral historian Stephen High's recent edited anthology entitled Beyond Testimony and Trauma, Oral History in the Aftermath of Mass Violence is part of these emerging voices in the field. And in a way, my paper this morning is a response to this call to explore new avenues, new intellectual terrains in the field of trauma and memory studies, and its vastly debated field. We are engaging with these issues that this conference is concerned about at a pivotal moment in South Africa, where questions about the past and how to interrupt the cycles of its repetition have come to dominate public debate. 2 days ago, I participated in the After Eight debate, which is a program hosted by the national radio station SAFM. The issue presented concerned the levels of violence that we are witnessing and what it would take to heal the country. The main narrative that emerged was callers connecting the seemingly unstoppable violence to the levels of corruption among government officials, from the very top to the ordinary functionary. It did not matter how often the host reminded callers that she was searching for strategies that might help our country to heal. Callers returned repeatedly to this problem of corruption among elected leaders as the issue at the heart of our problems with violence. Leadership matters, some of the callers seemed to suggest. I would agree with this, that in the aftermath of massive trauma that destroys not only lives, but the very heart and soul of our people's culture, leadership plays a central role in the process of identity formation. So I would like to begin with this issue because it seems to be one of the signifiers of the brokenness of our country. Perhaps this idea of brokenness was expressed most poignantly by Graça Machel, that voice of reason, as she continues to stand next to our memory of her husband's moral clarity. She was speaking at the memorial service of Mr. Josias, the Mozambican who was stabbed in full view of the public and in front of reporters' cameras. We need to begin to acknowledge that we are a tortured soul, Graça Machel said. The soul of the nation needs a deep search of what we have to do to heal and to heal ourselves as an African society. The damaging psychological structures of apartheid is something that we accept, but the continuing damage caused by some politicians in our society through their behavior, their statements, and their failure to engage in actions focused on building the common good is one of the greatest challenges we face. Wise leaders with moral stature bring stability to a country's young democracy, to paraphrase the biblical text. Yet the rampant corruption, scandals involving officials from the highest level of leadership in government to the very lowest in provincial offices of various departments, breeds disillusionment and chaos. And that is a reflection of our woundedness. The cruelest of all features of this current era of leadership is continuing injustice of the failure of service delivery, the collapse of health institutions, and the dire state of many schools. All this cuts to the core of the soul of our country, rupturing the very essence of our being as a nation. It is not surprising that we heard stories in the media of young raping our old. These young people who are raping their grandmothers are not the lost generation of apartheid. They are the born frees, born into this woundedness of the new South Africa. They were promised a future that would open up into a horizon of hope and opportunity. Instead, they have become disenchanted, waking up daily to the yawning void of emptiness. Very few of them will escape the fate of intergenerational poverty in their homes and communities. Worse, the conditions under which many of our young people grow up are irreconcilable with the promises of change under an ANC government. Under the current leadership, we seem to be edging inevitably closer to becoming a government of broken promises, corruption, and unaccountability. Who can forget the shocking images in our newspapers of the appalling conditions of some of the schools in the Eastern Cape? If children are treated as if their lives do not count, they are likely to grow up with very little or no pride in their identity and a sense of worthlessness. If they grow up feeling that their lives do not count, that they do not matter in the larger scheme of things, how can they be expected to bestow a sense of worth on others? The life circumstances of marginalized young people in our country are similar to those of their parents and grandparents under apartheid, except that they are worse off than their forebears. I say this because their parents and grandparents relegated to second class and even third class citizenship expected the apartheid government to treat them inhumanely. In this democracy of ours, however, many young people feel a deep sense of betrayal by a government they trusted. The broken promises of politicians is a traumatic pain that cuts very deep and explodes many young people's sense of hope. That is the essence of the depth of the woundedness of our young today. At the same time, as witnesses to the excesses of political elites and their business partners, they see that ours is a democracy that has benefited corrupt officials, their families, the family of the president and the president himself, and those with close ties to the president and his colleagues. The young people we see on our TV screens engaging in violent acts, seemingly without fear of consequences, desperately desire to be recognized as valued citizens. This issue of recognition is so critical. Recognition, they act up because in their quest for recognition, they desire to be acknowledged, and not only just acknowledge that you exist, but in terms of actions and the way that they are treated, they then act out. The image of the pool throwing students at UCT, for example, the young man who stabbed the Mozambican, as another example, in broad daylight, in full view of the journalist's cameras, signifies not only the story of the woundedness of our soul as a country, but also the violence that brought our nation into being. I don't have time to speak about the seduction of violence, how this past violence is so much connected to the violence today, but enough to draw the link there. by locating the story of the young man, for instance, who stabbed this Mozambican, his defiant act of violence that seems to have no consideration of consequences, by locating the story in the context of a country that faces a crisis of moral leadership, in a culture of political leadership in which very few leaders, if any, want to be accountable for their actions, we show the woundedness of the soul of our country. The young man's murderous actions are therefore not merely personal, they are symptomatic of a larger national struggle. And yet, all this must heal. And where do you draw from for ideas of how to heal our society? The closest that I know of is the work of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. We are aware, of course, that the commission is, you will cue me when you, the closest that I have in terms of a model that we have in our minds, or at least in our immediate history, is the model of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Imperfect as it was, there are strong insights in the commission that demonstrate to us that this too is possible. Before we had a Truth Commission in South Africa, we believed that the stories of people coming together, I like this Afrikaans word, the dunadering, you know, the coming towards one another. I like it because it's a word that moves, it's a word that performs the act of people coming together. We witnessed this on the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in ways that we never imagined. Before the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, experts told us that this is impossible. The canons, the political theories, canonical texts said that this cannot happen. You cannot reconcile with people who had caused you harm. You cannot forgive these deeds. And so indeed that it is, of course, difficult to forgive these deeds. And forgiveness itself, the word itself, that is not a catch-all. One needs to unpack this word a little bit more. But it is important to point out that this space of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, that context, within that context, emerged different subjectivities that were never imagined before, because the Truth and Reconciliation Commission offered a kind of a context, a holding context, that held these stories and narratives of people wherever they came, whichever directions they came from. And within that power of holding these moments, it created multiple levels of identifications. People who were perpetrators, bystanders, or beneficiaries, listening to the stories of victims and survivors, identifying with these stories, forcing themselves to look deep in their own consciences and to ask themselves the question, what did I do? Why did I not act? Where was I when this person's story was unfolding in a country that I had maintained through my vote? So these levels, layers and layers of identifications brought about incredible possibilities for transformation. We cannot ignore that. We can criticize the commission for all its faults, but we cannot ignore the fact that the Truth and Reconciliation Commission disrupted the canons of knowledge in this field. So I want to speak about transformation of traumatic memory and what's important when we think about this idea of trauma. Because when we think about transformation, change, reconciliation, we are really at the core of this statement. We're thinking about how we transform a memory of trauma, traumatic memories that disrupt people's sense of identities into a different kind of story. How do we create the space so that people tell different stories about the past? It is not to say that we want people to forget the past. We want them to remember, but to remember differently. This is the essence of this work of transformation. So I want to make brief remarks about the importance of narrative in trauma testimonies. At the end of my presentation, I'll also speak about the failure of narrative and why the arts and music are so important in this work of transformation. Narratives and storytelling had been considered an essential part of identity and meaning making. Accordingly, narrative inquiry has emerged prominently in research on how individuals and groups make sense of events in their lives. We're very lucky to have the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Young people are growing up today, some of whom are very immature, emotionally immature, for a range of reasons. One of which is that most of these young people come from families that no longer have that stability of family. A father, a mother, an extended family, a family life where they can sit around the table and talk about their lives. They no longer have that. This was destroyed. This was part of the cultural destruction, the destruction of the culture and the brokenness of the culture as a result of the past. They don't have that. Adults, we have a hope with adults because they can still express themselves in language. Memory then is fundamental to the stories that individuals tell about their lives, because memory helps to link experiences associatively with other events in one's life. In other words, individuals are able to put events in appropriate contexts in their life history. This thread of temporality and the ability to organize the past, which has been termed narrative memory, is profoundly disrupted by psychological trauma. Traumatic memories are notoriously difficult to be consigned to the victim or survivor's sense of the past. Lawrence Langer, who's a literary scholar in the Holocaust, of course, I mean, we criticize the Holocaust as having dominated the field, but we have to admit that there are great insights that you draw from the scholarship. Now, Lawrence Langer has spoken about this notion of timelessness, you know, that there is the problem of trauma. Part of the problem of trauma is linking the event itself to the experience of the trauma, and that people often, these acts of trauma often return even without the person's conscious awareness to haunt the person. We talk about a haunting, trauma is a haunting. These are the ghosts of the past, and all these words illustrate that it's trauma that returns intrusively into the lives of people that suffer trauma. So instead of assimilation into narrative memory, traumatic experiences are relived and acted out in a range of ways, including fear, anger, resentment, and all of these kinds of violent acts. I believe, and as I'm sure many of you do, that there is no disconnection between these notions that you're talking about now and the violence we've seen in our streets. When you think about this young man that, you know, we're using here as a kind of reference point, the young man who stabs this man in broad daylight, you look at this young man, you know, how he, you know, the sense of how he just almost like intentionally stabs this man. You have to wonder, what's going on? You know, we have to ask the question, what's going on here? You know, we have to actually engage with this idea of there's something else beyond just the desire to kill this person. There is layers and layers of stuff that's going on that has not been resolved. So we can imagine that all of these unresolved issues that are now playing out in these actions are a sign, they are signifiers that this act is not alone. This act is walking side by side several unfinished stories, because they have not been assimilated as part of the person's narrative. And so this is an attempt to sort of manage all of this complexity. The acting out is a way of holding it all together, a struggle as it were to contain it. So narrating traumatic memory then is an attempt by victims and survivors to reconstruct a shattered self, to find their voice, reclaim their sense of agency, and begin to reconstruct meaning from their traumatic experience. But trauma's undoing is also the undoing of communal bonds. The Truth and Reconciliation Commission played a very important role in this regard, because it provided the protective presence of a community within which narrative construction and meaning-making occurred and emerged. One of the most important observations from the TRC process is how witnesses sometimes appeared as if they were reclaiming the public space of the TRC hearings as a site for orchestrating the performance of their stories in a range of ways, verbally or as enactments. Sometimes the memories were recalled vividly, and this challenges the idea that trauma is unrepresented, cannot be represented. In most of the scholarship, there is this notion that trauma cannot be represented. And yet, we found and saw in the TRC that so many of these survivors would actually give detailed description of their traumas. We had an investigating committee, and these stories were investigated, and many of them were found to actually have occurred precisely in the way that victims describe the traumas. So we need to disrupt these notions of how trauma unfolds, and so that once we understand the reality of the experiences of people in our context, we can have better ways of dealing with the trauma rather than draw from other methodological approaches. So these, in the context of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission and in case of political trauma, where the trauma has a collective or shared aspect, the extension of the personal to the political, there's always the possibility of when one's personal experience is not only one's personal experience, but extends to a collective, to the political. There is always the possibility of remembering details of the trauma, precisely because of the collective and performative aspects of trauma testimony in the public space of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. That too is an insight into how we might begin to plan strategies of helping people to heal their trauma, even if we set aside the process of the TRC itself. But that in itself indicates that this is a way that we might begin to unravel the process of healing. The experience of narrating trauma unleashes a new form of subjectivity for survivors and their descendants when they break their silence, one that is imbued with agency and a power, the power of voice, as survivors reclaim their sense of dignity and worth. Take, for example, the story of a young man whose brother was killed in the cross-border, so-called cross-border operations in Namibia. The brother was part of the South African Defense Force. He was conscripted as a white young man who were required to serve in the army, and he died. He was blown, you know, up by a mortar bomb, and he came to the commission with his mother. And this man found it at the last moment. He was not going to testify. At the last moment, he handed us a paper that he had written, a story, written his story, and asked us to read the story. In the story, he takes over the voice of his brother, as if his brother's name was Owen McGregor. His name was Warren. He takes his brother Owen's voice and speaks directly to the leaders of apartheid and asks them, why did I die? Now, this can only happen in a Truth and Reconciliation Commission when people are being given a voice in very creative ways. Here is this man finding his voice, coming to the Truth and Reconciliation Commission as a white man, asking the apartheid government, why did I die? And he goes on to say, you lied to us, you said this is what we were fighting for, it wasn't what we were fighting for, and now I do not have a brother. He speaks as if his brother was speaking on his behalf. Or the experience of the narrative of a woman who was raped multiple times during detention. She describes the details of her unbearable experience and explains how she would take her soul out of her body and put it in a corner so that the rape was only on her body. And then telling us that if she were to appear on the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, she would want the commission to help her get her soul back. That already introduces a new perspective to us, that these are the idea of brokenness involves the brokenness of the soul. When we speak about people who have suffered trauma and people speak about PTSD symptoms and so on. There is a medicalization of this process that moves us away from recognizing the whole human being, that a human being has a spirit and has a soul. And so here is this woman articulating it so clearly that I took my soul out because that's who I am. And that's what I wanted to preserve and safeguard so that it is not broken. What was broken was just my body, just my body. Now, there's another story, of course, to talk about just the body, because it's not just the body. The indelible traumas live in the body, and the body, in expressing the traumas subsequently, in enacting these unfinished or inarticulable traumas, often, you know, uses itself to convey the traumas. So that too is important. Although there is the soul, there's also the body. But we need to be cognizant of all these aspects of traumatic experience so that we understand clearly what actually happens when people are traumatized. It is not simply a symptom of suffering that can be healed with medicine or with these other 12 steps. It is actually the destruction of the soul, of the essence of who the person is. Take again Norman de Jalata, whose husband's body was found with three others burned by the security police. I will return to Norman de later at the end of my presentation. The body of her husband, the charred body of her husband, was found in the fields outskirts of Port Elizabeth, beyond recognition. She faced her husband's killers at the Truth and Reconciliation Commission and told them, and this idea that here you are face to face with the man who did it. You're forcing him, as it were, to remember your husband not just as a communist or as a non-person, as a dehumanized person, as an antichrist, as some functioners of apartheid like to think about anti-apartheid activists. You're forcing this person to remember your husband with you as a father and your husband that you loved. She faces them. And at the end of her testimony, she lets out a piercing scream that shattered the stillness of the city hall where the TRC hearing was held. Now this too is a manifestation of the trauma and how victims and survivors can take hold of their right to express their traumas in ways that they want to. This scream that then reverberated like a speaking wound, reminding us all in the audience that this too is true. Reenacting itself and refusing to be silenced. It was as if she was daring to wail her years of pain and grief into this public space of the TRC, reclaiming her right to bear her pain for the world to see. What do we do with this? What do we do with this? With these cries, with these unfinished wails of victims who suffered so irreparably? I will return to this question at the end of my presentation. In all these narratives, when survivors find their voice, their stories seemed to transcend the passivity of victimhood, moving to a subject position of agency. They want to lay to rest the memory of the pain and abuse of the past, not in order to forget the past, but rather to heal their brokenness and the brokenness of their communities, to reclaim the dignity of the living and the dignity and respect of their loved ones who suffered dehumanization in life and in death. Now the image, in spite of these stories, the image of people coming from opposite sides of historical trauma, connecting through their shared pain, is a powerful symbol of solidarity. This issue crystallized for me, very briefly in Rwanda. We were in Rwanda, in fact, with Nomfundo Walaza. Theodine, I didn't see, is from Rwanda and one of the survivors living in South Africa. we were in Rwanda, and we went to a community of people who were working together, side by side, victims and perpetrator communities, living next door to the wives of men who murdered their husbands, and helping each other, trying to find a way of how do we live this life of post-genocide without destroying ourselves further, and how do we live it in a way that our children can do the dunadering, can come together without destroying one another. This crystallized to me this idea of, you know, people coming from two sides of different history. When one of the young men who sat next to a man who had killed his own father and talked to us about forgiving this man. Now, there's another conversation, of course, you know, the meaning of forgiveness. I'm not going to go into it. But suffice it to say that this allowed him to sit next to this man and to say, together we are going to change this community. We are going to meet every week to think about what are the kinds of activities that we can engage in order to heal our community. Now, one of our colleagues, Willem Verwoerd, we traveled with him as well, he asked him what he would say to people who would ask him whether he has a right to forgive on behalf of the dead. Now, again, this idea is very much part of the Holocaust scholarship, that the living cannot forgive on behalf of the dead. But if you think about it, the living are the carriers of this anger. They are the carriers of the frustration and the resentment and the pain and the hurt. And unless something happens to the living themselves on behalf of the dead, then the cycle of violence will never be interrupted. And so I believe that absolutely yes, the living have the responsibility to, if not forgive on behalf of the dead, they have to engage with the descendants of the perpetrators in some way. This, of course, assumes that the perpetrators themselves will recognize their deeds, because sometimes perpetrators take it for granted that they will be forgiven. They have a right, they make demands, you know. After all, we're talking about reconciliation, that time is past, you know, it's all gone, let's just, you know, forgive and move forward without taking the responsibility for their own actions. So this assumes that that will happen. So this young man then is involved in this work, and he says to us, he responds to Willem's question, what do you say when people ask you, can you forgive on behalf of the dead? And he says, well, First of all, I don't want to be a carrier of the hatred of the past. And secondly, I know for a fact my father will be very proud of me today that I'm working towards rebuilding our society. And thirdly, I don't want my children to hate the children of this man, because if they do that, then soon we will have another genocide. And so this captures for us the idea that precisely because we live in the same country, we have to engage in these kinds of alternative ways of dealing with our traumas. And these are some of the examples that show that this too is possible. That the experts were wrong. That we are now, in our generation, we are discovering new ways of engaging the past that heal in different ways. So the Truth Commission offered us all of this work. And showed us that people do and can come together. It sounds counterproductive that you can face the person who killed your loved one and say, actually, let's hold our hands together and move forward into the future. But the Truth Commission created the space, and I would say that even the work of the IJR today draws on that important example of the Truth Commission, that too is possible. The space for confrontation and listening and for initiating the difficult process of healing. These sites of testimony, of individual and shared experience, provided points of identification, as I said earlier in my presentation, entryways into the experiences of others, which enable comparison across critical registers of difference, appeal to the familiar, and the familial creates a context in which it is possible to engage empathic questions such as, how old was your daughter? when she was killed. And then the other person turning and asking, how old was your son when he died in Namibia? By grounding themselves in what is shared, they create mutual intelligibility. The shared experience of loss, for example, cuts across the distinction of black or white, Tutsi or Hutu. On the terrain of the horrific past, certain statements resonate deeply. My son was 18 years old when he was conscripted into the South African Defence Force during apartheid. He was brought back in a body bag, and I wasn't allowed to see him. Or my son was 18 when he joined the anti-apartheid struggle. He was abducted, tortured, and killed by apartheid security police. It is ironic that the same factors that can ignite and perpetuate animosity, fear and hatred, the love for those killed or maimed by the other, might also suspend those negative sentiments by providing a way into the experience of the enemy. Love and loss may provide a way out of violence. Ultimately, love and loss are what is common, and thus, in a sense, what is shared. Love and loss enable healing that opens new possibilities in the aftermath of violence. The loss is placed in the past where it belongs, but it is not forgotten. One lives side by side the past, but it is finally accepted and a new narrative emerges. Now, it's not always possible that these stories result in these kinds of positive outcomes. Sometimes perpetrators are incapable of feeling remorse, or bystanders are full of denial. They did not know that this was wrong. They never benefited from apartheid, and so on and so forth. They lack the capacity for the kind of empathic resonance that leads to a sense of care for the other, or what one might call a sense of remorse. Alternatively, they understand the moral implications of their actions, but in order to protect themselves from an inner shattering of the self, they try to hide from their shame. That's why I agree with Fanny when he raises the issue of whether guilt can be considered a trauma. I have written and spoken about this issue and believe very strongly that, particularly at the second generation level, guilt can be regarded as a trauma. Instead of facing the truth about their actions, they pervert the truth, claiming righteousness of their actions. I did it because they were killing our people. I did it because they were the Antichrist, or whatever justificatory reasons they use. This is a manifestation of the mechanism of splitting. Contradictory aspects of the self, the part that committed or was complicit in evil acts, and the part that is a good father, a mother, a lover, Christian, etc. These parts are kept apart, split off, and only one of these conflicting polarities, usually the good part, is embraced or acknowledged by the doer of the deed or by those who are associated with the deeds. Clive W. Lewis is a good example of this. For example, Clive W. Lewis was responsible for the assassination of Chris Hani, for those of you who are not South Africans. He told the Truth Commission that the killing of Hani could be justified because of his Christian faith. He told the commission, we as Christians are told that it is our duty to fight the Antichrist in whichever way we can. Now, expressions of accountability are inverted by simultaneously turning the spotlight of blame away from the self in order to project blame externally. Now, adults do this cleverly. Young children, the young people I spoke about earlier, they acted out against a perceived enemy. It's easy. Adults do that too, but what we witness, in my view, is very much representative of a representation of this kind of projecting something outward, putting the spotlight away from the self, the spotlight of the struggle and the trauma away towards another, so that it's the other who must suffer. This kind of splitting has been observed in our country very frequently. In fact, Brandon Humber, right, and Jason and him have written about this in quite a few articles about South Africans, why South Africans avoidance of guilt. Even so that even when a window opens, for instance, in these kinds of contexts, there often are windows that open for someone to feel safe enough to accept and confess to guilt, or to embrace their shame. Even when the small windows open to acknowledge complicity, another one may close to shut out the rising tide of shame and guilt that confronts the subject. The constant confrontation with one's complicity exerts an intolerable toll intrapsychically. To deal with the force of these emotions, a more subtle form of denial emerges. Speech acts similar to the We Christians statement by Clive W. Lewis, where expressions of accountability are inverted by simultaneously turning the spotlight of blame away from the subject and deployed in order to efface the feeling of personal responsibility. It's very important for us to understand this, because when we think about healing, we're not only thinking about healing survivors and their descendants. We're also talking about healing the wounded, the other side that is wounded too. So it's important for us to understand what's going on in the minds of people who carry the burden of shame and guilt by their own actions and sometimes by association with others who have committed the deeds. I have referred to this narrative strategy as reformative narratives, because they are deployed to hide from the inevitable reality and to soften the intrapsychic blow that is triggered by the feelings of shame and guilt. Now, it's not only intrapsychic, of course, it's also the social kind, the one that's obvious, you know, because one is shamed in public. But a lot of that, the reaction that is difficult, is happening internally. They also, the narratives, these narratives I call the reformative narratives, they also reflect underlying fear of a rupture in one's sense of identity. You know yourself to be a loving father, a caring individual, a compassionate individual. Suddenly, the mirror is held up and you are being reminded of what you did, or you did directly, or you did by association, or by complicity, or by lack of action. A mirror is held up, and so it's difficult for you to try to undo, you know, what you understand about yourself, and to embrace this other self that had been split off from yourself for a long time. It's very difficult to confront these feelings of shame. So a bit of understanding is necessary for us when we are working with people who come from these kinds of histories, so that we can take a much more invitational stance, so that people can open up and embrace their own shame and guilt. Because when people are unable to face their shame and guilt, it leaves no room for them then to reach out and connect with the suffering of another person. So these encounters, I think I want to really come to the end now by thinking about how else we might deepen understanding of, first of all, what is happening when people experience these return of historical memory, and understanding that people don't respond the same way to these experiences, firstly. And secondly, understanding how that past interacts with the present realities and coalesce to produce something else, a different kind of trauma. The fact that, for example, these people came to the Truth and Reconciliation, went back to their homes, and then after weeks or even months, sometimes people still hold on to that moment of relief, that cathartic experience having been at the Truth Commission and having been listened to, having their story acknowledged, having been recognized. They hold that for quite a long while, but soon the reality that my life has not changed sets in. So we need to understand all of this and to deepen this understanding and to find out how do we heal when people are faced with all these other realities. So what we know and what we found out from all this work is the recognition that healing must involve the other, is dependent on the other. Thus, the encounter is approached with a certain level of conscious and perhaps even unconscious intentionality, if one might speak about an unconscious intentionality. But this notion of an intentionality, you are approaching these conversations about transformation and healing with a certain level of intentionality. If it's not present, then all the more reason why the process has to be more invitational, so that the person makes an intention to come closer to the other person, to hear them at least as a starting point. While we may be separated by our historical past, at the same time, our past connects us, opening up a potential space for the emergence of unexpected human moments. In my current work, I have begun to speak about forgiveness as the wrong word, about forgiveness, the word as the wrong word. That what is important for us to understand is what emerges from this potential space when people are brought together. And so the notion that I have come to embrace is the notion of the emergence of the unexpected, because something falls into this space. You bring people together, you create the invitational space, you make this the space of potentialities, and something emerges from the space. You may call it forgiveness, you may call it connecting with another person, whatever you call it. There is something emergent. This is why at the beginning of this section of my presentation, I spoke about the emergence of new subjectivities that were made possible by the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Now, narrative, stories are important. This we know. Sometimes verbalizing stories in words about what we experience and where we want to go, how we want to get there, is not always possible. So we draw from the music and the arts. That is very important. It's not always discussed in our work. Across the globe, there are scholars who are beginning to engage with the arts as a way of healing communities. Music and the arts can give shape to our historical legacies and help us find a language with which to face our history in an attitude of building bridges for human connection across diversity, instead of breaking them down. The example I want to refer to is the work of Philip Miller, who is the composer of, some of you may know, the composition Rewind. Nomfundo, in fact, was involved in facilitating discussions that I will refer to very briefly at the end at the Baxter Theatre, where Rewind was staged. Now, Philip Miller takes voices of victims and survivors from the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. In fact, from all participants in the Truth Commission, perpetrators, bystanders, and uses these voices to create, what is clearly a beautiful piece of music, but otherwise moving piece of music. Moving in the sense that it really does move people into certain kinds of, you know, actions. Even if it is a beginning of movement, it does shape people, it does help people to establish new kinds of identifications. Now, in his composition, for instance, he offers an important alternative for engaging with the past. One of the stories that he uses at one point of this musical, it's based on Nomonde Galata's testimony that I referred to earlier. At the TRC, again, just to refresh your minds, Nomonde tried to tell a story of the important role that her husband played in her life, as well as the role he played in the community as a teacher, community leader, and activist who worked hard to bring about change in Cradock, worked hard for the rights of the people and the dignity of black people. Her voice during the testimony, replayed in Miller's musical production, carried all the emotions she experienced when she found out about the vicious murder of her husband. At one point during her testimony, which was replayed at the staging of Miller's Rewind at the Baxter Theater a few years ago, her voice faltered. And then she let out the scream that I referred to earlier, which just was such so shattering in the hall. It is this wailing voice that Miller resurrects from the archives of the TRC narratives. A soloist, Nozuko Teto, then picks up Nomonde Tsalata's crying voice and represents it through her magnificent and electrifying voice, soprano voice, several other voices in the choir, different voices and different colors of people who are singing with different levels of intensity, male and female voices, which in itself is representational of our country in a symbolic way, all these voices and all these racial groups singing the voice of a single woman whose cry represents the cry of so many victims. She takes this voice and sings it in a beautiful soprano, this wailing cry. The effect, when it's picked up by the choir, is a seamless repetition of this voice cry that reverberates like a reenactment of a wound that refuses to be silenced. Miller seems to be telling the audience that this is not yet past. Indeed, at the end of Miller's show, and this is the important part about this story, at the end of Miller's show at the Baxter, there is a still and dead silence in the hall. People don't stand up at the end of after the curtain call. They sit down in silence, the audience clearly moved by Miller's unsettling stories, and in particular by this voice, because you cannot avoid it. It sounds in your head, it cries, and it's a wailing cry of a deep pain. And they sit in reflective mood. And here is the power of the creative arts in bringing us to remembering the past. People did not leave, and they engaged instead in conversations around the foyer of the Baxter and around the stage. People who were strangers to one another. I remember there was a woman I've never met. She came to me, a white woman. She was crying and crying and sobbing and telling me that, I'm sorry, she did not do anything to me personally, but she was sobbing and sobbing and saying, I'm sorry. And so there were other groups of people around the foyer, talking to one another and sharing the most tragic, shameful, and confusing aspects of our past. Some of my friends told me about how people came and started sharing the stories of what happened to them, what they did. Little things like someone sharing a story around the table with her parents, you know, what her parents were saying, and feeling ashamed that she was part of that conversation. You know, little things, sounds little, but when you bring these stories into this kind of context, it evokes so much and opens up the space for such powerful conversations about how then we can leave this behind. Not to forget, leave it behind, move forward into telling new stories about our past. And that is the importance of these stories. Through these brief dialogue encounters with one another, we each can take some first steps into the light of hopefulness. Hope, not as an abstract concept, but as a moment imbued with the real possibility of deepening a sense of acknowledgement, understanding, and respect for one another's past. We can begin to feel some wisp of a fresh breeze coming and be part of that possibility of living reconciliation. Introducing music and the arts can offer language that unravels the complexity of the past and opens up the public space is a site for ethical engagement, a site for forging human links across time and space with the other, even an other responsible for one's irreparable loss.